Now, my premise is this, that when Jesus sent out the disciples in Matthew 10, he told them to expect persecution. When the preaching goes out over the whole world, what is the expected reaction to the worldwide preaching? It will be persecution on a much larger, much wider scale, much wider. Matthew 10, verse 7, as you go, preach, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand, corresponds to Matthew 24, 14, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness, and then shall the end come. Chapter 10, verse 17, but beware of men, for they will deliver you up to the councils, and they will scourge you in their synagogues. Verse 21, and the brother shall deliver up the brother to death, and the father, the child, and the children shall rise up against their parents and cause them to be put to death. That corresponds to Matthew 24, verse 8. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. Matthew 10, verse 18, you shall be brought before governors and kings for my sake for a testimony against them and the Gentiles. That matches up with Matthew 24, 14. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness. So you have the witness and the testimony coming together. So those two correspond. Matthew 10, verse 23, but when they persecute you in this city, flee ye into another. That corresponds with Matthew 24, verse 16, then let them which are in Judea flee into the mountains. Now next comes the smoking gun verse that to me nailed them together with a nail gun. Matthew 10, 22, but ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved. And then you come over to Matthew 24, verse 13, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. Those two, now either the Lord's talking about two independent, different tribulation periods, or he's talking about the same one. And I believe he's talking about the same one. That the tribulation he's talking about in Matthew chapter 24 is the same tribulation he's talking about in Matthew chapter 10 when he established the preaching. Which brings up some interesting thoughts. Number one, the persecution described in Matthew 10 is expected and desired. That's his expected and desired result. When you take that realization over to Matthew 24, then you suddenly find that the tribulation period is not the devil having his way. It is God having his way. It is Jesus having his way. That the tribulation period is the expected and the desired result of the preaching. It is the preaching which causes it. Now this becomes not troubling to me, but incredibly important because over the last couple of years I've come to see that the judgment is a good thing. When I talked about this in Virginia Beach, I showed that the judgment described in Matthew 25, the sheep and the goats judgment, is paralleled by the judgment which is described in Matthew chapter 10. I believe that the judgment described in Matthew 25 does not apply to the church. And here's why. When Jesus started talking to the disciples in Matthew 25, what was the first group judged? It was the sheep. And what was the judgment? Insomuch as you have done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. The wording of that makes a distinction between the group that he's judging and the group that they dealt with. So my conclusion then is that we're not talking about two groups, the sheep and the goats. We're talking about three groups. Now, who are the brethren of the Lord? Who did Jesus say were his brethren? But those who do the will of the Father, which is in heaven, those are the brethren. It changes whole sorts of things when you start to think about the judgment being not on what they did with Christ, but what they did to or for or against us.
Amen.
That changes things.
Amen.
It adds vigor to my preaching because I realize that on the day of judgment, number one, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 6, 1 and 2, know you not the saints shall judge the world? And if the world should be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters? Know you not we shall judge angels? How much more the things that pertain to this life? So I can endure all kinds of things, knowing in the back of my mind the day's going to come when they're going to sit in front of me. And I think that the judgment of the world is done in two stages. The first stage is that they're divided into sheep and goats. And that's a judgment. And that's the part we do, into the sheep or the goats. And then they're presented to the Lord and he passes judgment on them. And so it's both true that the saints judge the world and that Jesus judges the world. It's just a matter of how it's done, the procedure in which it's done. But now consider this. The Bible says that the judgment must begin in the house of God. So I began to think along the lines of where do I see the judgment of the church? When we start preaching, essentially what we do is we force the Christians and the crowd to make a choice whether they're going to stand with Christ or they're not. We are forcing the Christians to judge. And whether they know it or not, this is the judgment of God. That if they don't repent and turn around on the day of judgment, the Lord will say, on this day, you chose to be more offended that your sinner friends were offended at me than you were with the fact that they offend me on a daily basis. And so they will be sent to hell as a result of it. So I'm considering all these things, that the judgment of the church is actually beginning, that the separating of the wheat and the tares is beginning, the separating of the wheat from the chaff is beginning, the time when God is going to purify the church to make her ready to be clothed in white, which is the righteousness of saints, brings us to the great apostasy. What causes the great apostasy? Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted. Shall kill you. It is being required to choose Christ and saying, I don't want to. But it is the preaching. The preaching is acting like a pack of shepherd dogs herding the sheep into judgment, herding the church into judgment. Think about it, though, that consider what Jesus knew that he had to do. He had to die, he had to bring a division, and knew that division would kill him, but then he had people that were dedicated to him. And how dedicated were they? They were dedicated enough to be willing to throw their own parents into hell if Jesus asked them to. That's the level that he requires. Whosoever loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. But his disciples had made that choice. The choice that they made when they made it, the day of Gethsemane, that's the day when they were tried. Would they lay their life on the line? They realized they didn't. They forsook him. They repented. And they realized that really what was required of them wasn't not just to say, oh, I love Jesus and I'd lay down my life for him. What's required of Jesus is to lay down your life for it. Not just say you're going to lay down your life, but lay it down.